consultants in general, then of course we may employ people to give a specific advice where we're short of skills. We've raised the issue on our amendment, one or two particular posts where we're not sure that those skills exist among people that are being recruited. Not naming names, but I read a job description for the investor development manager, and I wondered really, I wasn't on the interview panel, but I wondered whether the strategic and specialist high-level technical advice in the job description I wrote is really something that's available through those means. We have looked at various places in the budget, frankly, and decided to leave them for the time being. IT, for example. Who amongst us has not reported a street plan? Anyway, all your hands go up, we did. But I found that you put a report in, and the present system wipes it off after a month, and it goes into another system. And the data has to be transferred manually from one system into another system and to be accessed again. So you know, we've got these problems that continue, which we hope we can solve, which I hope can be solved, but they're there, and they should be ironed out, and we would be more efficient as an organisation if they were ironed out. Now, Parish of Whitting Line, they get on very well, and he's smiling almost as much as in the picture he's taken from across with a local shopkeeper. I mentioned that shopkeeper in my original representation. And there is Councillor Whittingham, Reeve of us, strategically pasted in the background. Mr. Loughlin is the shopkeeper and his cleaver. The point we found was, of course, all that got published and was out on the streets before the leader made his decision on the Monday. Perhaps that's the price of the privilege of power. And turning to schools, as the rightly paid tribute to the work Councillor Kelly's been undertaking about apprentices, and I looked at the school's fund forum report. Under the government's proposals, 75% of our primary schools would get an increased funding, 23% decrease. Only one secondary school gets an increase, and 95% of our secondary schools' funding decreases. So I will be sending, in response to the consultation, some comparison of particular schools that I'm familiar with, in geographical areas I'm familiar with, and even though I've read the government paper and the House of Commons Library report, I have some difficulty, and it's not usual for me to have difficulty, which I love detail. I cannot track quite why our schools are suffering. There's a problem in Cheshire West as well, and even bigger problem in Cheshire East. This government is trying to help rural areas, I understand that, but why are we suffering to the extent of those areas? It's a question being asked many times in this chamber, but on this occasion, the consultation paper makes that shift clear, and we have to respond to it. So I'm just going to summarise briefly some of the points in our budget. The question was raised by a Labour leader about staffing. Well, we were very cautious about how many staff might be removed from the strategic role, and we found, in the end, there were vacancies there that we could take the money from and use. And the question we all need to face is, why is the 0.4 million in policy and strategy, 1 million in performance, without 700,000 in communications, why is that so great for a council's size, and is it achieving what we want it to achieve? Just to ruin Councillor Whittingham's there, I'm going to mention Peter Lane. A lot of the budget papers make it clear that for the next 12 months we're going to place heavy reliance on capital receipts, a substantial reliance on capital receipts in order to put in the transformation fund in order to get us through. It has taken us 5, 6, 7 years since I chaired Council Excellence. We still are reviewing our assets, still trying to make progress on some disposals. Many areas, members haven't yet been consulted about possible disposals. If we're going to get that volume of capital receipts in, then we all need to get our move on and see what may or may not happen and have genuine consultation about it. But to get back to highways, before I forget, I would suggest that else happened was over the next 12 months, there's 3.5 million per acre lane. There may be more instalments, so I won't give the total figure, because that's not been published, but 3.5 million has. It's the first instalment. We have to look at investing some of that capital and services. So to conclude, you've read the rest of my resolution, so I won't bore you with the detail, because you say you've read the more. Dislike rural abuse, we're going to leave the chair next day. We should spend less ourselves, so we don't need highly paid interims. We should get rid of the car parking charges, as per the previous debate. We should support the constituency committees so they don't scrabble around unlimited funds and coasting there. That work needs to continue. We haven't got effective monitoring the budget because the time between the reports coming out and the scrutiny committees looking at them is so great, the reports are meaningless, so we should move to more frequent reporting. And finally, my colleagues have mentioned one issue about the Wilmington Art Gallery, which is dear to members' hearts across the globe. The capital programme, because of the leisure decision, delays a decision on investment that's needed there, and we believe that that delay should take place and that should be released. So, Mr. Mayor, those are the key issues, and I'm grateful for the courtesy of Council and listening.
Thank you, Councillor Gilchrist. Okay, now we'll open up for debate here on the floor. Okay, thank you, Councillor Paul Stewart.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. For development of Wirral, it is infuriating to see this Tory government doing so, doing to our communities, while the Wirral Tories fail to stand up to their government for the development of Wirral. Whenever we look, the NHS, schools, policing, housing, social services, councils, and job centres, we find shocking damage to the social fabric of our country. This Tory government has systematically stripped our communities of assets, hit the poorest and the most vulnerable in society with welfare cuts, and continue their assault on local authorities like Wirral by starving us of funds. This is just another snapshot. There's far more happening, and the deeper and closer we look, the bleaker it gets. Damaging Tory austerity is a political choice, not a financial necessity. And let's not forget, it was the Lib Dems who allowed this to happen by joining into bed with the Tories.
Yeah.
in, you know, and Mr. Mayor, adding to that, it certainly does not bear well for the future of Brighton Wood Club for us, does it? Mr. Mayor, hopefully the driving leaders will give the council cast iron guarantee to protect all our greenbelts and not just selected sections of us. Mr. Mayor, the council budget is about choices. Our choices are for the benefit of people, where Labour's choices are simply punishing the residents it is here to serve. Mr. Mayor, I ask council to support the deserved amendment. Thank you.
Thank you. Sweetheart deal, avoided a 50%
2017-2010. Rest assured, all Labour administration would move into heaven and earth to defend frontline staff, council taxpayers, and the most vulnerable in rural. All of this despite the Tory government's cuts of £150 million since 2010, an additional £132 million over the next 4 years. There is a crisis in social care all over the country and world, and it's down to central government cuts. These cuts are unfair, they're driven by dogma, and they're totally unnecessary. There was cross-party recognition of this fact in this chamber in December last year. Let's not conveniently forget about that, shall we? Regarding alternative budgets, having read the proposals, the recommendations look more like an alternative reality, verging into fantasy, or it doesn't even have the credibility of being a proper alternative. In conclusion, Mr. Mayor, can I commend our Labour budget to the Chamber? It's pragmatic, it's real, and most importantly, it protects jobs, services, and most vulnerable in our society.
Instead, as the leader of the Conservative Group has revealed tonight, he wrote a very nice letter to the government
table the budget of the council is. So it does smack in the face of further letters from the three party leaders to ask to take more money when Councillor Davis is sending his own letters to the government saying thank you very much. Indeed, Mr Mayor, such was the priority for social care that we had in the debate in December that it took the leader of the council 7 weeks to draft the letter to go to the government to ask for more money for social care. Clearly not that much of a priority. Mr Mayor, we'll finish by saying that he has suggested that he wants it to be really open and honest about the council's finances, but as we've heard from Councillor Green, a further £1.3 million is to be spent on senior staff, new positions that don't currently exist, on top of the chief executive who was brought in for strategic change, on top of the two strategic directors who were brought in to manage the strategic change. You begin to wonder, Mr Mayor, how many directors and senior managers does the leader of the council need? And one further point, Mr Mayor, before I finish. I was very pleased to hear him say that he's make reference to his 20 pledges. Those on this side of the council chamber, Mr Mayor, thought the 20 pledges had died to death and that we haven't made any reference to them for some months now. And Mr Mayor, it seems to me that the 20 pledges is a bit like his statement.
two consecutive budgets. And I know it's not easy. I know that we can have a lot of problems. I certainly do. I should imagine most people doing it suffer the same. It should almost be a society for the protection of party leaders.